A mother of three enters a radio station. In front of her is a stage featuring a banner that reads, "Hold your wee for a wee." She joins the other contestants as employees set out bottles of water in front of them. A host explains that whoever drinks the most without urinating wins the coveted game console. A countdown begins, and as the bell tolls, she'll guzzle this bottle and as many as she can before the time runs out. By the end, she'll have consumed more than 8 bottles of water and be forced to leave the contest in severe pain. Little does she know that in those seemingly insignificant vessels was a substance that will take her life. You might remember how difficult it was to get your hands on a Wii if you were around in 2007. Even today, finding a PS5 at a store is an almost Herculean task. But how far would you go to get your grubby little mitts on the latest video game console? Jennifer Strange, age 28, was willing to participate in KDND-FM's contest, Hold Your Wii for a Wii. The competition promised a Nintendo Wii to whoever could drink the most water without urinating. During the competition, she told the radio host that she was doing it for her 3 kids. One contestant quit after drinking 8 bottles of water, but other participants, Strange included, continued even after the host gave them larger bottles. Calls poured in from listeners tuned into the radio station. Some were cheering on the contestants, while others had words of warning. One nurse phoned in saying,
"Those people that are drinking all that water can get sick and possibly die from water intoxication."
"Yeah, we're aware of that. They signed releases, so we're not responsible. It's okay."
They went on to say that our bodies were mostly made of water anyway, so what could possibly go wrong? A lot of things, actually. When it comes to drinking water, it's often believed that sweet H2O is good no matter the quantity. As long as you can get the minimum amount of water, nothing bad can happen from drinking too much, right? That's not entirely true. Like the radio host said, up to 60% of our mass is just water. However, that doesn't mean that our bodies are immune to the negative effects of putting too much of something in it. No matter how innocuous it is, a water balloon is made of way more water than we are, but if you fill it too fast, it'll still burst. Drinking too much water in a short period of time is dangerous and can lead to a condition called water intoxication. The term toxic actually just means harmful. We say that someone is intoxicated when they've had something alcoholic to drink because their bodies are regulating the poisonous effects. Likewise, we say water intoxication because your body is regulating the toxic effects of water. You know when you finally hit your stride with something? Be it an essay in school or a project at work? It always feels good when you can finally concentrate on the things you care about. Today's episode is sponsored by Roman Focus, a cognitive function and brain health supplement that may help you get back to that laser focus you crave. Roman has an in-house team of doctors to formulate quality supplements with elements that support focus, concentration, and overall cognitive function. With such ingredients as L-theanine, caffeine, and American ginseng, Roman Focus gives you calm energy you can feel within an hour of your first dose. Roman will even give you free shipping where you can get the product in 2 days. Ready to get focused? Go to getroman.com/brew and get $15 off your first order of Roman Focus. That's getroman.com/brew. But what are the toxic effects of water? The general symptoms include confusion, disorientation, nausea, and vomiting. In severe cases, water intoxication can cause swelling in the brain, leading to death. Miss Strange was not feeling well. Still, none of the contestants had urinated, as per the rules of the contest, and she quit after reaching second place, telling one of the hosts that she was in pain. At that point, she managed to drink 7.6 liters of water in 3 hours. She was bloated to the point that one of the hosts joked about her looking pregnant. As she quit the contest, she told the DJ, live on the air, that the hosts made excuses for her condition.
My head hurts. Aww. They keep telling me that it's the water, that it'll tell my head to hurt and then it'll make me puke.
After she left the radio station, Strange called into her work, telling them she was too sick to come in and went home. Only hours later, Strange's mother found her dead on the floor of her bathroom. How on earth could water, the very thing that life sprang from in Earth's infancy, possibly kill us? Drinking enough water to experience the intoxicating effects is pretty difficult for a person going about their daily routine. But if you're not careful, your next glass could be your last. Overhydrating is usually easy enough to avoid since our bodies will, you know, start feeling bad when we've drank too much. But accidental overhydration is much easier when you're out performing sports, working out, or doing manual labor. In short, it's much easier to overhydrate if you're dehydrated in the first place. But how much water is too much water? Technically, it's more how much water can you expel as opposed to how much water you can take in. If you could immediately expel all the water you take in, then overhydrating wouldn't be a problem. It all comes down to a bottleneck at your kidneys. Your kidneys can expel around 0.8 to 1 liter every hour. If you drink more than that, your kidneys will not be able to filter water as quickly as you take in. The problem with overhydrating is that it increases the amount of water in your blood, which can dilute electrolytes like sodium. If your sodium levels drop below 135 millimoles per liter, you'd be diagnosed with hyponatremia. Sure, not salty enough sounds like a good thing when it comes to internet discourse, but it does cause a lot of problems for your body. It's because sodium and other electrolytes help balance fluids in and outside of cells. If your blood sodium levels drop too far, then fluids will travel from your less salty blood, drawn to the saltier inside of cells to try and reach equilibrium. This will make your cells swell up, and that sucks on its own, but when your brain cells begin to swell, it becomes a matter of life and death. A buildup of fluid in the brain is called a cerebral edema, which can trigger seizures, brain damage, coma, and even death. Okay, but say you've already had too much water. How would medical staff go about treating you? One of the main issues with treating hyponatremia is a condition called osmotic demyelination syndrome. When your brain cells swell to the point that the myelin sheath, an organic layer covering nerve cells, is ruptured. The two conditions appear together because ODS is often caused by rapid changes in sodium levels. Doctors need to increase a patient with hyponatremia's blood sodium levels to prevent swelling associated with cerebral edema, but can't increase it too quickly for fear of triggering ODS. The first thing medical staff will establish is their patient's sodium levels with a blood test. Interestingly enough, blood sodium falls rapidly if a patient has already died, so a post-mortem blood test won't give an accurate picture of the cause of death. In those cases, doctors will take a vitreous tissue sample from the gel-like goop between your eye lens and retina, since their sodium levels are much more stable after death. Eye needles. Yay. Once doctors know that a living patient's sodium levels are dangerously low, they'll immediately begin treatment. The main two methods include the administration of a saline solution, basically just salt water, and occasionally the use of diuretics. For hyponatremia, medical staff will give you a 3% saline solution in the form of 3 100-milliliter boluses, which works much quicker than an IV drip. This is important because staff will want to reduce pressure on the brain ASAP, while avoiding ODS-inducing rapid changes in sodium. Thankfully, doctors can improve a patient's condition in the first few hours after coming into the hospital without risking too much. This did get me thinking though. Is it possible to prevent hyponatremia by consuming electrolyte beverages like sports drinks instead of water? Jonathan Duggas, PhD, in an article where he examines the effects of electrolyte drinks, writes that even if you consume electrolyte sports drinks in similar amounts to water you've lost while working out, you will still see a net loss in blood sodium levels. Duggas continues, noting that while electrolyte drinks did slow the loss of blood sodium, drinking Gatorade or Powerade will not prevent conditions like hyponatremia. To add to this, we also have cases like Zyrees Oliver. The 17-year-old high school student was at football practice when he started feeling cramps he believed was due to dehydration. He then proceeded to drink 2 gallons of water, followed by 2 gallons of Gatorade. That's about 7.5 liters of fluids, far more fluid than his body could handle. He wasn't able to drive, so his mother came to pick him up after practice. He felt a little better that night, but the following morning, only hours before he was set to start his senior year of high school, he collapsed and had to be airlifted to the hospital. Shortly after he arrived, medical staff declared him brain dead as a result of hyponatremia. And 5 days later, his family made the difficult decision to remove him from life support. Unfortunately, drinking additional electrolytes won't prevent overhydration. As we learned earlier, at a certain point, your kidneys simply cannot expel fluid more than what they're designed to do. The other treatment method, diuretics, otherwise called water pills, are drugs that help your body excrete water at an increased rate. Diuretics are used less commonly, and really only used in addition to the administration of saline due to them preventing electrolyte reabsorption. You may have heard that caffeine is naturally a diuretic, but lemons, onions, watermelon, and cucumbers are also in the same category. Returning to Jennifer Strange's case, her husband, now a widower, sued the station for damages. As it turned out, the contest was not approved by upper management, nor was a plan sent to the station's legal team for review. In addition to that, no warnings were given to the competitors of any health risks they ran by participating. The jury, thankfully, sided with Mr. Strange and found that Entercom Sacramento LLC, the holding company that owned the radio station, was liable for his wife's death. They owed her family $16.5 million in damages. 10 employees of the station were fired, including all hosts of the contest. At the end of the day, our bodies are just big, juicy machines that need just the right balance of chemicals to work properly. But that can get tricky. We just need to make sure that we're not only listening to how our bodies feel, but also spend time to understand exactly why we feel the way we do. Get $15 off your first order of Roman Focus at GetRoman.com/brew.